She's your sister, dude. She's gotta be, and you made out with her, man. What's wrong with you, you pervert?
Well, I didn't know she was my sister when I kissed her, so it's not my fault. And she's one of the hottest girls on the planet.
You just said your sister's hot. What a freak. You're going to hell, man.
I gotta tell her what happened, why I got weird. And for God's sakes, I gotta treat her like a sister.
Flowers in the Attic by V.C. Andrews, the controversial potboiler classic. So, I remember years ago my mother actually telling me about this book. She was like, I remember that book. They had to remove it, I think, from our library in the high school that she attended way back when the book, you know, actually came out. And I made a note of that because whenever your parents tell you about a book that was so controversial and shocking that they had to remove it out of the library in the school, you know you're in for something. Maybe not something good, but definitely something. And this book was definitely something. But I've wanted to read it ever since then just to satisfy my own curiosity. And this book is the one that is largely remembered as the incest book. It shocked and offended sensibilities because it went to a place that a lot, and actually nearly all other authors, don't want to go. But, you know, I don't really have any sensibilities to offend, and plus incest is nothing to me. After you've read Robert Heinlein's Time Enough for Love, incest is not shocking after you read that book. The incest in that book is so far beyond what is contained within the pages of Flowers in the Attic. You've got brothers banging sisters in that book. You've got sons banging mothers in that book. You've got a dude who bangs a female clone version of himself. Incest loses all potential to shock after reading that book. And plus, beyond that, I live in freaking Arkansas. I mean, That shit is just known to, you know, transpire in this state almost as much as like Alabama. You know, that's why we have that joke. What do you call a 12-year-old girl in Arkansas with three older brothers who's still a virgin? A track star. And, you know, no joke, not even lying. I used to go to school with a guy who attended church with a guy who had a kid with his own mother. And yeah, it do happen. And yeah, so just stay the heck out of Arkansas is all I can say. But yeah, incest is not that shocking really to me, I guess. So I was kind of just went into this book like, you know, what is it that so many people just, you know, blush and cover their mouths whenever they read it? And this book is such a mixed bag of both good and bad. This book is largely regarded as just trash by a lot of people. A lot of the reviews that you see of this book are that it's just like shock value garbage, just meant to, you know, titillate and appall and get attention that way. I do definitely see where that argument stems from, but I don't quite agree with it wholeheartedly. And I'm going to explain why. So what is Flowers in the Attic all about? Well, it takes place in the 1950s, and it follows the Dahlenganger children. That's a weird name, too, which is remarked upon in the book. You have four kids. The oldest is the son, Christopher. The next is the daughter, Kathy, who serves as the book's narrator. Then you have their two younger twin siblings, Corey and Carrie. All their names start with C. The father's name is also Christopher, and then the mother's name is Corinne, so everything starts with a C, just kind of odd. But anyway, so their dad gets killed early on in the book in a car accident, and they subsequently learn that their mother is actually the heir apparent to a vast, just ridiculous fortune But alas, she has been disinherited because she married the man that she married. And so now, since she's largely useless because she was just, you know, a housewife who didn't know how to do anything, and they have bills piling up, she has to worm her way back into her father's affections in order to get reinstated into his will. So they pack up and head to Virginia, where they go to live at Foxworth Hall, or whatever it's called, because her maiden name was Foxworth. Foxworth Hall, I think. Big, fancy, ritzy-ass mansion. And so then she's like, I can't let my dad know that I had kids with my husband, as reasons will be revealed. So she's like, y'all have to stay up here in the attic. Or not really in the attic. They stay in a room that contains the passageway to the attic, and they have to stay locked in that room, and they can go up in the attic, but those are the only two places they can go. And so she tells them they have to stay here, and no one can know about them until she wins back her father's affections. And at the onset, she says it'll only take like a week tops, and then I'll be back in that will, and you can come down and we'll be happy. But of course, it ends up being over 3 years that these kids have to stay locked in this attic. And over the course of that, over the duration of that stay, of course, they enter puberty and begin to mature, and then they develop feelings for each other because they have no other outlet for the desires and the yearnings that they are now feeling. And so, of course, that ultimately leads to the infamous incest scene. But before we get to that, let's talk about the pros and cons of this book. I think there's probably more cons than there are pros, but such as it is, let me try to lay them out as I see them. The writing in Flowers in the Attic is... there are good aspects to it, but it's largely lackluster. Now, let me explain. V.C. Andrews' descriptive ability is more than competent. The way that she, you know, paints pictures with words, the way that she describes the events that happen, is actually pretty well done, mostly. It's a little bit flowery at times, but it's not dull. And her word choice is sometimes quite nice. There were actually some really well-worded passages in this book that really jumped out at me. On that level, there is something to admire, but the dialogue in this book is the single worst dialogue I have ever read in any book, ever, bar none. Not only does no character have an individuated voice, she uses the dialogue in this book to... it's so perfunctory, and she uses the dialogue to propel the story forward rather than just be reflections of the characters who speak it. So what we get is characters who talk like no humans you are ever going to meet. You know, I've talked, I think it was about Don DeLillo. Strange to be comparing Flowers in the Attic to a Don DeLillo novel, but I mentioned in my reviews of Don DeLillo's novels that none of his characters really speak like real human beings, because he does a similar thing where he'll use the dialogue in ways that you probably shouldn't use dialogue. But even his books are not as bad as this. Like, the characters in this book speak like so inhumanly. It's like robots. It's like an alien came to Earth and then tried to talk in a convincing way that mimics what it thinks human speech is like, but it fails miserably. That's what the dialogue in this book is like. It is so clumsy. It is so just sledgehammer, take the story. We're moving the plot along with copious exposition delivered in pages-long monologues. That's what the dialogue is like. It sucks. It's bad. But the descriptive ability is actually, again, the way that she narrates and the way that she just describes what's happening is more than competent, I thought. So it almost balances out a little bit. But of course, we got to get to the punctuation. And the narrative voice. Because this book is narrated by Kathy, who is the eldest daughter. And by the way, there's a glaring contradiction in the opening page of the book. She says, she opens the book in the prologue by saying, as I write this down based off of the journals and memorandums that I kept throughout our years of confinement, so it's implied that she's writing this out based on notes that she had compiled while they were locked up in the attic. Yeah, that doesn't happen because it never shows her writing anything down. So it's like, it's just a contradiction right out the gate. But that's the least of the problems with the narration. Kathy's narrating this years after the fact, and yet she still sounds like a 12-year-old, and a really stupid 12-year-old at that, a really naive and inept 12-year-old. And the punctuation in this book is so egregious. In case you don't know, whenever you're just writing narration, you know, just unless you're writing anything except dialogue, you don't want to use exclamation marks. You want to use those sparingly. I guess maybe it's acceptable in certain instances within the narration to include an exclamation mark, maybe, you know, just here or there. But don't overdo it, because it makes it read differently when it has different punctuation at the ends of each sentence. And this book was punctuated so horrendously and so atrociously that it read unintentionally in a comedic fashion. There are more exclamation marks in this book than any book I've ever read, no question. So almost every sentence, even sentences that aren't exciting in the slightest, end with an exclamation mark. It is so badly done, and so it's like, what were you thinking? You should know at least not to do that. So the writing in this book, it has glimmers. Again, the way that she describes stuff is actually pretty good. Her word choice is actually pretty good, I thought. But the dialogue is abysmal. The punctuation is egregious, and the narrative voice with which this book is told is wildly kind of at odds with how it should really sound. But moving on to the characters, there are really only two characters, or three, I guess, if you count the mother. That is Kathy, the narrator, and Christopher, her older brother, who she grows attracted to sexually over the course of the story. There's also the grandmother, who is just the archetypal religious fundamentalist bitch who just, it's just like every other word out of her mouth is just this ridiculous, overblown biblical rhetoric. But the mother is also there, and it's her and Kathy and Chris that comprise the three main characters. The younger twin characters are there, but they don't really factor in that much into the real characterization that the book tries to do. But I thought the characters in this book were decent, at least. This is kind of a coming-of-age story, kind of a darker, a little bit more twisted coming-of-age story, but they do come of age. Kathy and Christopher definitely do change over the course of this book. And so I will give it that. The mother also changes in a vastly worse kind of way, but I will give it credit where credit is due. I think the characters did demonstrate a certain level of dynamism over the course of this story. So the plot of this story, now to get to the incest angle of it, because I know that's what everyone wants to hear about this book, is... you know, the juicy parts of it. And I'm going to say this right now. The incest in this book was actually handled very, very well. This book did a really great job of setting that up and making that far more palatable than I think most readers would really anticipate it being. And it made it feel way, like, entirely natural. Because I guess, really, in this scenario, it would be natural. You know, I mean, if you have an adolescent boy and an adolescent girl, even if they're blood kin, locked up together for years with no other outlets whatsoever, that's probably going to happen. And the way it goes down in this book actually was fairly well handled, I think. So... incest saturates this book, okay? From the first page to the last, it is palpable in this book. We learn that the reason why Corinne had been disinherited from her father's will is because she actually committed an act of incest herself by marrying her half-uncle. That is to say, her grandfather had a child with a much younger woman when he was an older man, who is actually her age and who came to live with them and whom she fell in love with and subsequently married and had kids with. And so her dad, because that was actually her dad's half-brother that she married, he cut her out. So it's already incestuous even before the story starts. But when it does start, it's immediately apparent where this is going. The way that the characters view each other and the way that they come to view each other is decidedly intimate over the course of this story. But again, I think it's really well done. The way that Chris and Kathy come to like rely on each other and the way that they come to form like these stand-in parental roles, the mother and father of their two younger twin siblings, it makes it feel natural. Again, I guess it just makes it feel natural. Of course, the way that the incest actually happens is different than what I was anticipating, because up until then we have been shown rather kind of, you know, really affectionate scenes, really warm scenes of where they're relying on each other because their hopes are just being continually dashed of ever getting out of the attic. Because the mother eventually remarries, but it's stipulated in her dad's will that if it was ever discovered that she had kids from her previous marriage, she would be disinherited again. So now she can't get them out of the attic, and so she eventually just stops caring about them, and she remarries and goes off to live with another husband, and she even actually poisons them at the end of the book. Spoilers, I'm just going to spoil this, you know, be warned, sorry, too late, I spoiled it. She even ends up poisoning them at the end of the book to try to kill them to get them out of her hair, and she was such a cold-hearted bitch, and she's so materialistic, and I guess the main theme of this book, other than incest, is greed, because she is so greedy and so money-hungry that she, you know, she's going to try to kill her kids and keep them locked up in an attic for over 3 years, but as their hopes continually get dashed because it becomes, you know, blatantly apparent to us as the reader that they're never going to get it, that she's never going to let them out, they have to really rely on each other and they come to lean on each other. And so that really leads to some more tender scenes than I, you know, had been led to believe this probably had. And honestly, those were really sweet. Again, you're walking a tightrope because a lot of people are, the main reaction is, that's his sister, that's her brother. But it really is sweet, honestly, within the context of this book. And so I was hoping that it would just be like a natural progression of that. That would have been pretty palatable, I thought, but the way that it goes down is not very sweet. So Kathy, towards the end, as it becomes apparent that they're going to be locked up in this attic until they die, they decide to steal a bunch of money from their now loaded mother and her new husband, and they're going to make a break for it. So they sneak out after dark, and Kathy sneaks out one night to go steal some money from her mother's purse, and then she sees her stepdad in a chair asleep, her new stepdad, who's much younger than her mother as well, in a chair asleep, and so she's just overcome with this strange desire to just plant one on him right then and there. So she goes over there and she like kisses him for whatever reason, and then she runs back to the room. And then when Chris goes down to steal money the next night, he overhears the stepdad telling the mom that he had this strangest dream about this lovely blonde-haired girl who kissed him and then ran away. And so Chris is like, "You whore! How could you do that?" And so then it's like a quasi rape scene, and it's unintentionally funny again because of the ridiculous way it's punctuated with nothing but exclamation marks wall to wall. And so he's like, "You bitch! How could you do this?" And then he's like, "You're mine. You're always gonna be mine. I won't." It's like the police song, Roxanne. "I won't share you with another man." And so then he like initiates what's basically a rape. But then afterwards, she's like, "But it was my fault too because I tempted him or whatever." This book is not very progressive in its sexual dynamics. It very much is kind of like, it's kind of victim blaming. It's very much laying the burden of not being raped kind of at the feet of women, which that, you know, modern day sensibilities recoil at that, and rightly so, because the duty to not rape should only be laid at the feet of people who would do the raping. So, I mean, but it's not very progressive in its outlook like that, because Kathy, after Chris quasi-rapes her, but she kind of does enjoy it. She's like, "It was my fault too. I drove him to that point. I tempted him, blah, 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 whatnot." It is definitely dated in that regard. Reading that, it kind of is, yeah, it's not very, again, progressive. Although it is progressive in some other ways. There's a major theme throughout this book of being the captain of one's own ship and being in charge of one's own destiny, especially in terms of women, because the mother, Corinne, is entirely useless because she's just a housewife who's never had to work, who's never learned any kind of skill. And so they go through this entire ordeal because she has to rely on other men for money. And Kathy makes several remarks over the course of the book that, "I'm never going to be like that. I'm never going to rely on a man for subsistence." And that is really applause worthy because housewifery, I just myself would highly discourage because I've seen the results of what that leads to, especially when the man is no longer in the picture, and it's really sad. So I was proud to see that, but in its sexual politics, it's rather antiquated. But the major flaw with this book, the major fundamental weakness to it, is that there's not really any reason to care for these characters because they are so ridiculously, absurdly stupid. The problem is that when you have a story about people locked in a room, or, you know, where they're trapped and they have to figure a way out, and, you know, the suspense in this is supposed to come from the fact that they have to try to extricate themselves from whatever position they're in. But with this story, they can leave whenever they want. They routinely climb out the window and, like, shimmy down. They make, like, a sheet ladder, you know, a sheet rope out of sheets, and they routinely climb down and walk around outside. And then there is a part in this book where the grandmother, the hyper-religious grandmother, walks in and sees Chris staring fixedly at Kathy while she's undressed. And she's like, "I knew it. It's incest all over again." So she proceeds to starve them because she's the only one that brings them food every day. She proceeds to starve them for 2 weeks. And they don't do anything. And that's why they're so freaking stupid. Like, they are, like, after a week, they're so physically drained and feeble that they can barely move. And Kathy's like, "Chris, we have to try to escape now." And he's like, "We'll give it one more week, and if we're still alive, then we'll run." I'm like, "What are you doing? There's a window right there that you go out of all the time. Why would you stay here?" I mean, seriously, every time, as I was reading this book, I was like, "You are the 4 stupidest little shits I have ever seen in my life." Nobody would stand for the kind of treatment that they get when they can just walk out whenever they want. Like, they're kept in the attic for, you know, to be, they're kept in the attic for secrecy, because they don't want, obviously, anybody to know that they exist, but nevertheless, there's windows that they lower themselves down from to go out and, like, swim and walk around, and yet, whenever they're starving to death, they don't do it. And when it becomes glaringly apparent that the mother no longer gives any kind of a shit about them and that she's just actively basically trying to kill them, especially towards the end, she's actively trying to murder them, and then they're still just like, we'll give her one more chance, surely she'll do the right thing. We've been here 3 years, and we're slowly dying of arsenic poisoning, but we're going to give her one more chance. I'm like, why are you so naive? Why are you so stupid? You know, and it's hard. You gotta make your protagonist flawed to have something to overcome. You gotta give them a shortcoming, a weakness to render conflict for us to become invested in. But you can't make your protagonist just be flat out stupid. And the four Dahlemganger kids in this book are so incredibly stupid, it defies belief. And so a lot of the emotional impact that this book was supposed to have was kind of lessened because none of it really had to happen. They're basically there by choice. And that's the reason why this entire setup is kind of contrived. It's just a little bit over the top. Because when I went into this book, I was anticipating, even though I'd heard that it was just, you know, garbage, just, you know, potboiler trash, I was wanting it to be like a really intense psychological drama kind of thing. But I think it aimed for that, but it ended up coming off more as campy, unintentionally comedic melodrama. But despite all that, there were still points in the book where it actually did make me feel something. There was actually points in the book where I actually was kind of saddened by some of the events that occurred. And so I'll give it that. It is not without emotional impact, and there are positives to it, but there is a lot wrong with this. And I understand why so many people label this just, you know, just trash. I don't think it is quite, but I understand where that assessment comes from. Now, this is the first book in a long series of books. By the way, V.C. Andrews, despite having died in, you know, 30-ish at least years ago, she's still turning out books on a yearly basis because her name was so popular and had such value to it that her estate actually hired a ghostwriter to continue writing books under her name. That's why you still get V.C. Andrews books today, even though she's been dead since like the 80s. She's still beyond the grave churning them out. But this series of books, I think there was four initially. I think they're Flowers in the Attic, Petals on the Wind, If There Be Thorns, and Seeds of Yesterday. And I think they've all been turned into Lifetime movies by now. But I have heard that all the sequels are just atrocious. I've heard that the next book, and by the way, it doesn't really have to have a sequel. It doesn't really end on a cliffhanger. Like, there's definitely the implication that there could be more to the story, that there's more to write, but it wraps itself up pretty well at the end. So I'm just stopping here because I read the book that I wanted to read just to know what it was like, and I got something. I got an experience, I'll give it that. But I don't think I'm going to continue on reading any of the sequels because I've heard they're just horrible. Flowers in the Attic, to rate that book right now, I think I will have to give it just a good, solid, even C. That's a lot higher than I think a lot of other people might give it. But I think that as schlocky as it is, as over the top as it is, as melodramatic as it is, it does still have something of merit to it. Just however minute, it has some little kernel of merit to it. And so I'm just going to give it a good C. Not a C+, but also a little bit more than a C-, because it kept my attention. I'll give it that. It did keep my attention. And it did make me feel some emotions at certain points of the story. There were some sad moments as their hopes are just being dashed. So it's not a complete failure. The writing was good in certain areas, but appallingly bad in other areas. But on the whole, I've read worse books. I understand why this is controversial, or at least I can understand why it's controversial, even though it's not nearly as provocative, I think, or bad as a lot of people think it is. But of course, that word that hangs over it, the incest word that hangs over it, obviously connotes a lot. So I get why people, you know, are kind of, this book is kind of hushity-hush. But it's really not that bad. It's not erotica, I don't think. In fact, there's a lot in this that was just not downright kind of disgusting. Honestly, yeah, I don't really think it's all that erotic at all. But it was something. I've read worse books. I've definitely read better. But I'm glad I read this. I'm glad I read this just to, you know, see what it's like. And yeah, so Flowers in the Attic, I'll give it a C. Probably won't read any of the other books in the series, but yeah, I'll give it a C. So yeah, Flowers in the Attic by B.C. Andrews. Have you read Flowers in the Attic or any of the other books in the series? If you have, let me know down in the comments what you thought about the book, whether you have agreed or disagreed with anything I've said here today. If you haven't read Flowers in the Attic, you might want to read it. I mean, again, there's worse books out there, and there's way better books out there, but there is worse books out there. I think it may hold your attention, if nothing else, but, I mean, yeah, read it if you want. I don't care. I have, and now I know what the controversy is about, so my curiosity has been satisfied. So, yeah, and as always, if you have enjoyed anything you've seen or heard here today, remember to like, subscribe, help the channel out a little bit. I would greatly appreciate it. And until next time, peace.